Take it if you need it.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. I'd like to welcome you to Sacramento Central Seventh-day Adventist Church here in sunny California. For those of you who are watching on live streaming, we'd like to welcome you as well this afternoon to this event, which we here on the ground have been looking forward to for several weeks. We have a program in our church, which is every second and fourth Sabbath, called Discipleship University. And we've had some very good speakers thus far. We're getting ready to conclude this semester, if you like. But we're very pleased today to have with us a very well-known speaker, not just a speaker, professor of theology, administrator, book editor, pastor. Does that just about cover it all, I think? Well, I can't speak too highly, in a humble way, of course, of our guest speaker this afternoon, Dr. Herb Douglas. Dr. Douglas, we'd like to welcome you here today. And we're so glad you're here with your wife and family and friends. I'm just going to give a brief introduction. There was a book came out in 1957 called Questions on Doctrine. And if you want, or if we want to get a good account from somebody who was there at the time, discussing the cause of why this came about, how it was published, and what were and what still are the consequences today, then nothing beats having somebody who was there on the ground. And Dr. Douglas was there at the time. So Dr. Douglas, we're glad you're here. Are you ready to go? He's ready to go. So keep him in your prayers. It's hot under the lights. We've got him as comfortable as we can. We've got water, everything else. And if you need anything, though you're on camera, just scream and you'll have an English butler here to take care of you. Okay? I don't want to sound too flippant, because this is a tremendous subject, as vast repercussions. So before we begin, I'd like us to bow our heads, and we'll invite the good Lord's presence. Gracious Father in heaven, this afternoon, we thank you that we can be here in your house, and we're here, Lord, thankful we could be actually here in your presence, as your servant, Dr. Herbert Douglas, is here to give us his own personal experience of what happened in 1957, but not just his own experience from a subjective standpoint, but a very objective position as well, Lord. So we're thankful. This is quite a unique event. And so we pray now that you would bless him, that you would anoint him with the Holy Spirit, that you would give him the ability to feel comfortable here in this literally a hot seat with the lights. But we just pray that you would use him today, and may we all be blessed. May we listen closely and take heed and be inspired, prepared and warned for the last great battle that is just down the road. And if we don't know our history, then we don't know where we're going. So bless us now to this end, and thank you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Dr. Douglas, thank you very much indeed, and God be with you.
Where could a man get a more gracious introduction? I call him my limey friend. Whenever we exchange emails, I end it with cheers, and he caught on to that because he's been hearing that since he was born. This is a very gracious church, too. So much good comes out of this church. All around the world, this church is well known. Let's pray that the energy of this church can just be shared in such a way that we can have many churches like this around the world. China, Africa, Ukraine, and even England. England needs it. And so today, we're here because we want to share a story. This is not a theological lecture, although you'll hear a lot of theology in it. No, just a story of what happened to this church. Many years ago, at least 60, when the Adventist Church took a course that they never were on before. It was a good fortune for me. I can't understand it. But I was back in Washington, sent by Pacific Union College, where I'd been teaching, to complete my BD degree, which is a three-year degree in those days, comparable to a PhD. But while I was there, out of the blue came an invitation from the editors of the Seventh-day Adventist Bible Commentary to please come and join them in the last two volumes, the New Testament volumes. Well, I leaped at the chance, of course. Now, the seminary in those days was adjacent to the General Conference building, which was very large. And the General Conference building was next door to the Review and Herald Publishing Association. Now, how could you find a better coordination of great events that were just beginning to happen? And so all I had to do is walk from this building over to this building when I left my classes and go to the editorial offices, and the story began. The most divisive book in the Adventist Church over the last 50 years. My good friend George Knight wrote that in the introduction to this book, which is the annotated volume of Questions on Doctrine. Now, I tried very hard over a number of days to get all these books onto my PowerPoint. I've never had a problem in 15 years of making a PowerPoint. I could not get most of these books on, you know, copy, paste, boom. But I have some of them, and so I had to bring some of them to show you what this book really looks like, which is the annotated copy. It came out about 2004, 2005, which was the occasion for the 2007 Bible Conference at Seminary, Andrews University, 2007. That was quite an occasion. We owe it to all the pastors and administrators who have been trained in the last 50 years at least, since 1957, into thinking that QOD represents the theology of this church. It's amazing. Why is QOD called this most decisive book? Well, some have called that division in the church a fork in the road. Now, something happened in 1957 that changed the course of Adventist thinking for more than a century. I'm repeating that because that is so much a core to what we're thinking about tonight. We would not have the independent ministries in this church if it were not for the rocks or rapids in the flow of Adventist history. I'm not saying every independent ministry somehow pulled it off right, but we wouldn't have them. And I could name them, there's about 30 of them that would not even exist if they didn't think something was wrong with this particular book. And it became a new way of talking in the Adventist church. And we're still doing it today, friends, as to the nature of sin, the humanity of Jesus, righteousness by faith, the delay in Christ's return, and what role does the Holy Spirit have in preparing the people to meet their Lord in the last days? The Holy Spirit's been with us ever since Genesis, but not in the way that He has wanted to work in those people preparing to meet the Lord. So what exactly happened in 1957? Well, we're two prominent Calvinist evangelicals met with three prominent Adventist leaders. And the Adventists did their very best to prove that they were real Christians and not a cult. Like one of the prominent evangelicals was writing in a book about us. God had his hand in this whole thing. Now, whatever we say about Questions on Doctrine, I want you to be very clear that there's much in that book that's very valuable. Very valuable. Many chapters that are very valuable. We're talking about certain core chapters that change the entire history of theological training in the last 60 years. So, does any of this matter? Many people in the church say, look, that's a long time ago. I've heard this in many meetings. Herb, this is a long time ago. Why keep bringing it up? Just ask yourself, is there someone in this room, or is there someone anywhere who has ever gone through predicaments and struggles and lived long enough to have fading hopes and then wonder, does anybody care? Does anybody really understand what I'm going through? Does it matter? If Jesus came as Adam was before he sinned, or came as Adam after he sinned? Very fundamental question. We might get into that. I don't know how much time we're going to have this afternoon. Or does it really matter? If Jesus came and every child is born today, with all the results of DNA and the transmission of weakness and liabilities down through the food chain of the human family, does it matter? In 1957, two tectonic plates, similar to those that cause our earthquakes, especially for those in California understand all this, especially in the Pacific Rim. Now look, well, I think you can see some of that. The Pacific Rim is that red line around the western coast of the United States and stretching out into Japan, a great big, but that open sea is a Pacific plate. There are other plates. San Joaquin plate, for example. Well, these plates are constantly touching each other. They're constantly moving very slowly, but over time, some of these plates ride over the other one. And that's when you have 8-point, 9-point earthquakes. Sometimes they just bump each other. And that you have lesser earthquakes. Every single day, we have earthquakes in California. Every single day. But some days, it may be, then you know that something really happened. That's what happened in 1957, theologically speaking. The colliding of two different theological systems caused the 1957 theological earthquake. Imagine trying to bring together Presbyterians and Methodists. You say, well, that's impossible. Well, why wouldn't people say that about merging evangelicals with Adventists? Two tectonic plates that guaranteed a theological earthquake or the fork in the road collided on these questions. Look at these questions now. I'm glad they're on the board so you could look at it with your eyes. Listening to a person may be interesting up to a point, but if you can't read it, I've learned this a long time ago, if people can't read what you're saying, 90% is lost. So at least you can read what I'm saying. Was the atonement completed on the cross? Are we born sinners? Oh, pardon me, but I know that there are very good people in this room who may take two different positions on these. We just want to walk it through today. How human was Jesus? Does God expect his followers to be really overcomers? Is there such a thing as really overcoming sin? Well, it depends on what you say to answer number one. What is the measure of New Testament faith? How do you describe New Testament faith, especially in relation to justification, sanctification, glorification? These words are not written in the Bible because Paul never wrote those words. He wrote in Greek. So it's our way of trying to figure out what he said. And each definition of those words depends upon the kind of theology a person uses when he translates the Bible. But that one word, faith, is the word, the one word, that has divided Christian churches for 2,000 years. And it still divides the Adventist church. So how it all started, how did it, what happened leading up to 1957? Well, Toby Unruh, the president of the Pennsylvania Conference, and he wrote a letter of appreciation to Dr. Barnhouse, who had a radio program, on how Barnhouse was trying to explain righteousness by faith. Well, Barnhouse received that letter from the president of the Pennsylvania Conference of Seventh-day Adventists, and he was more than amazed. He said, Adventists, they believe in righteousness by works. How come this man is praising me for what I'm saying? And so the letters went back and forth, and Unruh sent him Steps to Christ. The next issue of Eternity, which Dr. Barnhouse was the editor of for over 30 years, he wrote an answer to Steps to Christ. And these were some of the words he wrote. It was false in all its parts, that it promoted universalism, half-truths. These are quotes from the article as he's trying to respond to Toby Unruh. And is too much in favor and emphasizing God's love for unregenerate men. God couldn't do that. He made unregenerate men. Remember the predestinarians. And so in 1950, Unruh gave it up. It's going nowhere. Well, now enter another man who was an editor of another magazine, like Eternity. This was our hope. He wrote an editorial on the Adventist Church as it understood Christ's deity. And he really raked us up and down for having a Jesus that was human, not God, just a sinful, fallen human nature. How could you use those words? Well, Elder Froome, whom you're going to meet a little later, he saw that. And Froome fired back a letter to him. Dr. Schuller, you really don't understand. That's a tragic mistake that you found those few words, sinful, fallen nature, because those have been expunged. It's not in that book anymore. And I can tell you the story on that, but that would take too much time. So then English wrote an apology in the next edition, and Froome insisted that he was looking at a terrible misuse of Ellen White. Well, that started something. And now enters Walter Martin, a young, energetic researcher. He's 1 year older than I am at that time. He died many years ago. And he was one of Barnhouse's consulting editors for the magazine Eternity, but he was finishing up a book on the rise of the cults. He is well known as an apologetic writer on Jehovah's Witnesses, Mormons, Christian Scientists, and Seventh-day Adventists. But the Holy Spirit was working here. Before he finished his book, he had the sense that he needed to get his facts clear, straight from the horse's mouth. And so he turned over his, he talked to Barnhouse about it. Barnhouse says, well, I'll get you a line. I'll show you my correspondence with Unruh. He's the president of the Adventist Conference here in Pennsylvania. And so Martin was in touch with Unruh, and then with Leroy Froome, and because he knew Froome, because of that mammoth four-volume prophetic guidance of our fathers, that's well-known, well-accepted in Orthodox, generally the Protestant churches look at Froome and his book as something rather marvelous. And so they got talking, and Martin says, well, why don't we just sit down with some of your men, and I'll bring some of my men, and we'll talk it all over and see where we are and see how far we can go. And Froome invited in Walter Reed, an older man who was well-versed in Hebrew and Greek, and then a short time later brought in Roy Allen Anderson. He was the editor of Ministry Magazine. Roy Allen, Australian, had a voice that was melodious. It was a voice that everybody loved to hear. And he could spin a story and come up with a sermon that was just knock you out. He was a great preacher. I loved Allen. I just loved him. And so the conferences began in March of 1955. They ended in May of 1956. Here's Walter Ralston Martin, 1928, and he died in 1989. Prolific writer, had a great Bible Answer radio program, known generally, at least in the evangelical world. He founded the Christian Research Institute, and in 1985, the year I went to Weimar Institute, he was one of our New Start guests, and he was a joy. He is a very affable guy, very pleasant. And Donald Gray Barnhouse, 1895-1960, he died too soon too, I think. He was a great guy. He knew how to work 25 hours a day. In September of 1956, Eternity Magazine published an article. Are the Seventh-day Adventists Christians? Now this is a year after they started the conversations. He answered affirmatively. Can you imagine how that went through the Adventist Church? Never mind the Presbyterian Church. In the past he had excluded them for some of their teachings. But in this article he described us as a well, his wife called that article a blockbuster. That's in her biography of her husband after he died. And she wrote, the action was immediate. Outraged canceling of subscriptions. Many cancellations. Or some grateful commendation because he had the course and the courage to admit he had been wrong in the past about the Adventists. Along with Walter Martin, Barnhouse argued, it was a very interesting time, that the Adventists held Barnhouse, held the basic doctrines of Christianity. No problem with that. Albeit, although with some heterodox teachings. But that's not important because they were right on the essentials. Well, you can imagine how pleased Froome and Anderson and Washington leadership was. Well, the personal insights onto these Adventist trio, Dr. Reed was the oldest, knew his languages, but not a systematic theologian. I love to listen to the whistle of his English voice, by the way, and his white goatee. Just the perfect model. Now, Roy Allen, he was a revered preacher and public evangelist, editor of ministry, could write so well in my home several times. We just enjoyed each other. And Ellie Froom, well known for his massive contributions, as I said before, in prophetic faith of our fathers, and then conditionalist faith of our fathers, another two volumes. Remarkable piece of work. This guy, pardon me, this man, he's my buddy, was a towering kind of guy. And he would come into the review office where I was editor later in the 1970s, flop down a chair, and start talking theology and what's up. He knew I've been writing editorials against everything he said for years. He knew that every week. But we never let theology get between us. I refuse to let theology spoil a good friendship. I was probably, they say I was one of the last persons to hold his hand while he died. Now R.A., I'm probably getting ahead of myself, well, that's Froom and Anderson. And by the way, for those who know some of the history of the Adventist Church and the commentary, you might hear the word Frieda. Well, Frieda is a little nickname that we came up with. I think it was Don Neufeld who coined it, Frieda, so that we could just say with shorthand who we're talking about. Frieda, Froom, Reed, Anderson. You got it? Froom, Reed, Anderson. Frieda. Okay, now you're up on Adventist history. Anderson would call me probably every 4 or 5 weeks, consistently, through the 80s and 90s. He was an older man now. And his voice was a little different. Herb, what are we going to do about our church? He saw what was happening in the last 40 years at that time. I never had the heart to tell him, if we didn't mess it up in 57, you wouldn't be asking that question tonight. I just never did. In these meetings over many months, the Calvinists and the Adventists merged their agreement on the theological issues that were in contest, but the very issues that were the foundation of the Adventist system. But they were told that if you keep on believing what you're writing here, you think Adventists believe, you are giving courage to the lunatic fringe in the Adventist church. People who write like that, it's a lunatic fringe. Well, they had plenty, they had all kinds of books there, or people for the last 90 years were using correct descriptions of the kind of humanity Jesus had. And so the merging of the two tectonic plates became so elastic in shaping each other that they avoided an earthquake in 4057. But it wasn't for long. So why should we revisit QOD today? That's a big question. We owe it to the pastors and administrators who have been schooled since 1957 into thinking that QOD represents our core Adventist beliefs. I'm talking about from grade 1 through grade 16. And most every church since. And we owe it to millions of Adventists who have very little clue as to why their church has been so divided for 50 years, 60 years now. and why there are so many independent ministries. We owe it to our church to help them understand, why is it in Sabbath school, most every Sabbath school and most any church has its divisions whenever anything important is brought up. And time has come to undo the theological malfeasance done to Ellen White by QOD's unwarranted subheads used to grasp them.
Sorry to interrupt. Because the microphone keeps falling off, we're having to do this different circumstance. My apologies.
This isn't working too well?
It's because it keeps falling down.
Oh.
It's better to have something obtrusive than a microphone that keeps falling off.
Yep, you should stick it to my head. Maybe this is Doug's and it's not supposed to go on anybody else's.
It is a mic, but I'm going to take this one here and I'm just going to tuck it down here in case we need a little bit more audio, we can use it. It becomes kind of a lapel mic.
Well, I'm sure in the film they're going to have, all this is going to be erased out. Every flub I have is going to be erased like that. They promised me that. Anytime you see anything on TV, you can believe that that's not the way it really took place in the studio. No. Everybody has been edited out. Every flub, every mistake, or everything that looked like a lapse of time, that's all removed like that. So it looks smooth. So I don't kid myself. They're going to do that for me. Are we ready? We must come to that place in this church where we must undo the malfeasance, the theological malfeasance done to Ellen White in the writing of Questions on Doctrine. The use of her quotations and how they'll use the ellipsis, one boom, boom, leave out a phrase or leave out a sentence and pick it up later to avoid telling the audience what she meant. It happened over and over. I'll tell you, when I went down to the review in 1971 to be associate editor under Ken Wood, one of the greatest men I've ever known, I had time to do research on what I was writing every week. And I began to look at some of the quotations and questions on doctrine. And then I looked in the real volumes where they took the quotation. I was scandalized. Day after day, I'd bring the Signs of the Time or the Review and Herald or wherever the quotation was from, and also bring in Questions on Doctrine. I said, Ken, can you see what I see? Because the first time he was aware of it. He just took for granted these men would never do that. After a few days of that, he was absolutely almost ready to rip out any future Questions on Doctrine book. It was so unfair to Ellen White. And that became my interest in, because I wasn't that interested in Questions on Doctrine until then. But then when I saw that, I said, that does it. Just plain malfeasance. The time must come to highlight those who did speak out against the thinking and method of our three Adventist spokesmen. These were three friends of mine. to the day of their death, and yet they were doing things that were beyond them. They were not prepared to deal systematically with men who were pretty trained in their point of view of theology. Now, let's think about them. M.L. Andreessen, he was the senior Adventist theologian, head of systematic theology at the seminary for a number of years. The one who wrote our strongest books in language everybody could understand, M.L. Andreessen. Merlin Neff, Richard Lewis, Pacific Press book editors, very sharp. Very sharp. Ted Karsage, president of Central Union Conference. Ray Cottrell. There are just some of them who were aroused at what they were learning even before the book was published. But here's what Ted said to his, he was president of the Central Union Conference. This is what he wrote. Under a guise of sweet honeyed words, oozing with so-called Christian fellowship, Mr. Martin proceeds to serve up the same theological hash that our spiritual forefathers had to refute years ago. So that's what the ministers in the Central Union got. And then he wrote a letter to Elder Figure, the president of the General Conference. And he said, QOD, a clever and subtle attempt to undermine the foundational doctrines of Seventh-day Adventists. Can you write any clearer English than that? Amen. Now Cottrell, what a man. He helped to teach me how to edit. I can talk a long time on Ray Cottrell. But he was associate editor, and he sat there, and I was here when we were at our desks. And he wrote to the president of the General Conference, "Let us be certain that nothing gets into the book that will take us the next 50 years to live down." I didn't even read that until 2057. 2007, that's 57 years, 50 years. I said, how prophetic can a guy be? I know the question that we kept hearing, and down through the years I keep trying to respond to. Well, why were the editors of the SDA Bible Commentary so relatively quiet? We wrote letters quietly to the president of General Conference. We wrote letters to Froome and to Anderson because we didn't want to get into a real knockdown, drag out, because we never thought the book would go anywhere. Okay, let's get it published. But who's going to buy it? But a larger picture serves as the backdrop. The commentary editors did not want to take sides publicly because the Review and Herald Association had gone very deep financially into the hundreds of thousands of dollars that were going into producing the commentary, and that took a lot of money, a lot of research. Just a lot of money. And there's only one way for publishing houses to get their money back, and that's to sell their goods. They've got to sell their goods. And so we didn't want to get into any, you know, fighting City Hall where the General Conference was against what the Review was trying to say and jeopardize the sale of the commentary. We knew that the commentary would make a larger contribution to the church than that book would ever make, although we couldn't see in advance too far. We never dreamed how divisive QOD would become or how overwhelming the marketing program became. And that would be a 15 minutes just to talk about how they went into a marketing program. It was unbelievable. Our Bible commentary avoids the errors of QOD by emphasizing classic Adventist great controversy principles. Recognize that the purpose of the gospel is to prepare the willing to be saved. In a single sentence, that's the difference between the Adventist church and every other church. Never mind QOD. We are trying to prepare, God is trying to use this church to prepare it to live forever. And he needs people right now to step up and show the world clearly what kind of a God is running the universe so we can trust him more. Amen. However, Francis Nichols, editor of the Review and Herald, editorial chief, I don't know how he did it, 4 o'clock in the morning, every morning, he was there in his office of the Bible commentary. He wrote a private letter. He learned all these things afterwards. He wrote a private letter to the GC president that some QOD statements, on mature judgment and consideration, we are unable to support. He was number one writer in the denomination. Didn't matter. Francis D. Nichol, Francis David Nichol, love that guy. Editor for, well, he became a 1925 associate editor, then he became full editor, chairman of the whiteboard. Walter Martin described Nichol, whom he got to know real well, as the most able Adventist apologist. Now, coming from Martin, that's pretty good. I remember the day as if it were yesterday. The QOD trio told the Review and Herald Publishing Association and the book editor, who was trying to do his best to keep this thing throttled down and cleaned up on the manuscript, that they would permit no more editing on their manuscript. It had already come down like that because we're trying to remove a lot of fluff. And from now on, it's going to be just plain text basis. That is, we're going to give you the material, and you print it, and you market it, but no more editing. When we heard that, it was stunned us, really. And that famous day, when Ray Cottrell left the room, and I thought he went to the bathroom, he comes back with a pail of water, a little basin with a cloth over his hand, and comes over and puts it on the shelf, and we all knew what we had to do. We got up to wash our hands in that basin. No more responsibility on the part of the Review and Herald for what goes into Questions on Doctrine. Lots of interesting stories. It's a fatal attempt, folks, to join a limited understanding of Adventist big picture, of the great controversy theme, with the Augustinian, Calvinism, sovereignty of God, big picture. You can't have one merging with the other. The central question for both parties is, what does God want to attempt to do with the gospel? What's his plan? What do you expect the gospel to do for people? You start answering that question, and you follow it through to the end, and you're an Adventist. The great controversy theme on QOD's side, on God's side. One, God's purpose is to prove Satan wrong in his charges against God's character and his government. I usually take a whole semester, folk, in going through everything I'm saying tonight, so I'm going over very rapidly. Number two, all creation is planted in God's fertile field of freedom. Love did not come first. freedom come first. You can't love without freedom. Try it sometime on your wife or your husband or your boyfriend. You're going to marry me or else. It doesn't work that way. Freedom comes first. Thus, this world became a living laboratory as to who was right. That's why this world was created. That's why we have procreation in this world. No other world has it. There's something about the human family that was give a story to people as to how God looks upon us. But that's another story. The great controversy theme on Satan's side, Lucifer's, Satan's aim, was to misrepresent God, who had made him his director of communication. He was God's right-hand man. He was the vice president of the universe. He had seen everybody else created. He can tell every angel what his DNA is, or anything else. But he grew envious of Jesus. Why? Well, Jesus became archangel to tell the story of how God was really like on the angel level. That's another story in itself. Number two, he resented the laws that restricted his own powers to do as he pleased. Thus, as you know the story, Satan, with his highly intelligent mind, began to sow seeds of distrust, always subtle, always in the background. The real manipulator, you never knew who was on what side, but he knew how to work people. And that led to the rebellion, with one-third of the angels trusting him and not God. You have to be very good to do that. His subtle mind led the angels to view God as severe and harsh, judgmental, unfair in his outline of what is best for the creature. In other words, that God did not really give anyone freedom, and that was unfair. You can see that kind of, you hear it today. You can read it almost in any newspaper with somebody making some kind of comment. How does all this go about in QOD? Calvinists get around the main issue of fairness by declaring, one, God made some to be saved and others to be lost. That's his judgment. He's sovereign. He can do as he pleases. And by the way, he has a hell fire for those who don't make it. After all, who made them sinners so that they would die, well, live on in everlasting hell? Thus, men and women really don't have any choice regarding their salvation. It sounds so cruel, doesn't it, to us talking like this? When you talk to evangelicals and Presbyterians, they have a sweeter way of saying it, and I know that, and I respect it. But whatever was done on the cross for them does not do anything to your condition as a man or woman, but does give you a new kind of looking at your future, because as soon as you accept what Jesus did on the cross, you're saved. It's a marvelous system. It's quicker than ours. Sanctification takes time. So that leads to 5 points of Calvinism, and some of you historians and theologians know exactly what I mean. But it shows you, when I say this, how close some of the Adventist theology today is to basic Calvinism. Total depravity. Why? We're born sinners. And I hear that throughout the Adventist denomination. Unconditional election. Well, we don't believe that, because that means you're elected by God's fiat. He told what you would be like before you're born. Limited atonement. Jesus died for the elect. Well, the Adventists come close to it when they say, justification for you really grants you only righteousness right now, but not a transformed life. Irresistible grace, those who are elected to be saved are given the gift of faith. Again, confusion over the word faith. And then perseverance of the elect. Once saved, always saved. I hear a language like that often in some of our conversations. The awful persecution of the Armenians by the Calvinists, I've given you an example where that kind of theology leads people. Run down the Armenians, the people who believed that God gave people freedom to choose, that salvation is a matter of a person choosing to be saved. The Calvinists could not understand that. They put a lot to the stake, persecuted so many of them. For Armenians, predestination was unbiblical. Just wasn't there. Jesus died for everybody who were willing, and discipleship was response of thoughtful people. Infant baptism was meaningless, and on that point, they at least had somebody who wouldn't baptize their babies. Kill them. You're doing the Lord a favor. It was not a good time to be alive. And the key word in Questions on Doctrine was responsibility. If the Adventists had really worked that word over, you would have had altogether different approaches to answering Martin's questions. For 400 years, Protestants have been divided over what happened on the cross. You know about it, you read about it in our books. And forensic justification becomes a word that becomes almost a shibboleth. If you don't know how to use that word, you're in or out. Doug Batchelor could not preach his sermons by going along with certain lines of thought in the Adventist church on forensic. In other words, when Jesus died on the cross, he died for you. You raise your hand if you accept Jesus, you're in. You're in. Justification is the passport to heaven. God's wrath is appeased. I don't want to get into that too much because it just takes too much of my time. The Adventist fatal flaws in Questions on Doctrine. Adventists did not fit the Calvinist or Armenian framework, but QOD Trio was unprepared to portray classic Adventism. The more I talked with Leroy Froome and R.A., we could see that they didn't quite grasp, in 1957, the Great Controversy theme. It grew on them. The nature of man, we do not believe an immortal soul, and that gets mixed up in their theology. Jesus as our high priest completed the purpose of his death on the cross. We say no. The atonement goes on beyond the cross. The cross was only a means to an end. It was not the end of anything. Now, until you understand that, you don't understand what God is trying to do in transforming people into people he can trust to live with angels forever. Jesus was born a real human being. Hebrews 2:17, Hebrews 4:15, as clear as words can be made. You never see that in their language, trying to explain their side. And all this infects STA eschatology. In other words, what kind of people become sheep or goats? Just that simple question. Who's going to choose between sheep and goats? Do we have third and fourth kinds of goats and sheep? What kind of people are identified in Revelation 14:12? And 2 Peter 3:10, 14. We can see that later. 50 years of muddle. That's what it's been since 1957. 1957 is one of the two moments when we rewrote Adventist history. The other one was 1888. You know, in football games, you don't do it in baseball. or basketball. It'd be neat if you did it, basketball. Sure needed. But you have a replay camera. And that replay goes back over from different camera angles as to what really happened in that play. Was it a fumble? Did he go over the goal line? And so you have a replay, and sometimes the referees are reversed. We need replays on 1888. We need replays in 1957. Doctrinally, 1957, among the most significant, why Jesus came the way he did. I'm trying to boil it down to a few lines. And the core importance of his high priestly ministry and the function of the Holy Spirit. I think those are core doctrine. If we don't understand them, there's so much that gets confused in our church today in every Sabbath school lesson. Historically, in 1888, for example, another rewrite, the astonishing claim that the key contribution of the 1888 General Conference and later years, I'm quoting, was the recovery of the Protestant Reformation regarding righteousness by faith. We now understood what Luther meant in his faith, but we misunderstood it for 1844 until 1888. But now we finally got it right. Pure, misguided, upside-down thinking. The damage? Both rewrites have poisoned current studies of these core Adventist truths and locked the door for so many people on what EGW called the most precious message that would prepare a people for translation. That's an afternoon to spend a couple hours on to get started. That door is finally unlocked. Just read the only responsible historical review in print, Ron Duffield's The Return of the Latter Rain. You like that title? That was an amazing choice of words. The return, because so many people say, we're waiting for it, we're praying for it. No, we're praying for the return of the latter rain. And you know, in 1896, Ellen White wrote, well, to the editor of Review and Herald, the Holy Spirit has been kept back and denied the work that he wanted to do because men in our leadership have turned away from him. The latter rain just plain and went into all kinds of misunderstandings of what the latter rain should be doing. Got into all kinds of strange things happening in our church. And evangelists who are hitting the rail train, the sawdust floors in our camp meetings year after year, talking about the latter rain. If you can get it, pray for it, because it'll turn your white hair black again. And many other things will happen to you. These men were serious. They were good men. They were good men. They were good men, folk. But they misunderstood what was happening in 1888. And we still have that same problem today. An amazing spirit of retaliation developed against those who differed from QOD, such as heavy advertising of books that taught the impossibility of perfection. 1963, while still in sinful flesh, I'm quoting from that book, new definitions for perfection that muted human cooperation with divine power in overcoming sin now. They couldn't get divine power back into perfection, and so they said that's legalism. Amazing. A new vocabulary. Some of you are old enough to know what I'm talking about. Straw men came into language in a conversation that made people, well, tried to keep them off balance. I remember at a meeting of the Pacific Union board, full board meeting, and they had me speak for some time on somewhat of what I'm talking about today. And when I was through, one particular high-ranking member said, "Herb, have you ever seen a perfect person? What did that have to do with the theological structure of what I was saying? Straw men, trying to keep people off balance. Sin was built into human nature and not a choice." I can't. I have to feel sorry for people who believe that, because they pick it up from their Sabbath school teachers, they pick it up from church school teachers and the preachers here and there. That's all they know. These are good people, but that's all they know. Emphasizing behavior, that's legalism. Perfect people think they can meet Satan on their own ground, you know. That's straw man. Focusing on personal perfection, you're taking your mind off Jesus. I've seen that over and over again. Books by our publishing houses. Maybe some of you have read these books by Malcolm Bull and Keith Lockhart. They are two young men who went through Andrews University. I think they may, can't be sure, but they're in England now, and one of them is professor of art at Oxford University, and the other is a very distinguished journalist, well known in Britain. I believe the Holy Spirit led them to write a book, Searching for a Sanctuary, first edition. In the second edition, they really plowed more into it. Oh, I didn't bring it. I'm so sorry. Seeking a Sanctuary, 2007, Indiana University. When I read that book, I said, this is God's answer to some of the things that some of us were trying to say. Because they took the Adventist Church in the last 80 years that they took it, line by line, decade by decade. And in 1957, they saw that dramatic shift in Adventist thinking and how thinking at the seminary really was changed. I can't spend more time on that, but I'll get into it a little bit. They saw the impasse, for example, when one is confused about the nature of sin, just a simple subject, and how that created a real fork in the road at the seminary. They recognized Australian Bob Brinsmead's quandary, because Bob Brinsmead was one of the independent ministries, very bright guy. He and I have had many wonderful talks. We still back and forth. He's an older man. Well, we're both old now. But we write back and forth on email. He believes he's way out there, and he admits it. But he had a sharp mind. And he knew that Ellen White was so clear that the last generation will be overcomers, like Revelation tells us we must be. And he said, how can we be overcomers when we have sin built into us when we were born? He didn't see the nature of sin. And he said, finally, he said, I got it. We have to go through Gethsemane, like Jesus went through, all of us. We call it the garden experience. And many of his followers in Brinsmead group, and quite a group, fell for that. I'm sure it didn't last too long. But that's what happens when you get off on one of these, you know, to get your finger on the right button, you can get to this button. There's so much I want to say on that. So here's Milton Andreasen again and Ted Heppenstall. Ted passed away now. But when we were going to conventions together with this city or that city, he would look me up in my motel room and sit down and get caught up and, you know, sit on a bed, he on that bed, and I on this bed. We would talk about this and talk about that. We were just pals. He knew where I was. I knew where he was. But we never let theology get between us. But he developed a theological structure at the seminary that trained a whole generation. Well, Bull and Lockhart saw that Heppenstall's new theology, I'm quoting, directly affected many other aspects of Adventist theology. Amazing change of emphasis on key Adventist words. Justification. Believers are now made right immediately rather than waiting for glorification. And he was part right, of course. Justification is the making right of a person. But that, to him and others, that is justification in Romans. And I'm looking at Romans 2. And I don't see it the way they see it. And other people don't see it either. But that made the day for... Huh. Oh, so much. You see, if you get justification now in such a way that you're made right now, you don't need to wait for glorification. You're already right, and you don't have to work on perfection or overcoming. That's just plain legalism. Because you're okay right now. You're justified. From the early 60s, Heppenstall rarely mentioned the prospect of translation. You look for it in his books. And never discussed the character of the last generation, thus breaking the connection between Adventist theology of how we are saved in Adventist study of last day events. You just didn't have any more eschatology in that respect. Interesting that Graham Bradford, an Australian, wrote a book that many people say is a kiss of death on Ellen White, entitled More Than a Prophet. But I picked up this quotation in one of his pages. The church had changed from its views, its ideas on the nature of Christ, sinless perfection, and the atonement, due largely to the teachings of Heppenstall. And he was a Heppenstall follower. In fact, strongly supporting Heppenstall. Now, the stark contrast between M.L. Andreasen, who was premier senior systematic theologian of the seminary, and Ted Heppenstall, senior systematic theologian for many years. Andreasen was known for his logic and where everything that he said had such coherence. It was simple to follow him from one dot to the next, to the last generation, straight line, from the nature of sin to the humanity of Jesus, through the atonement in all its phases, thus proving Satan to be a liar and God fair and just. I just gave you a great controversy in just a few words. That others living as Jesus lived with no advantages Jesus having no advantages more than any other human being has, and empowered by the Holy Spirit, Jesus was a sinless man because he prayed for the Holy Spirit to keep him faithful. That we also can overcome all temptations from without or within, and also prove Satan a liar and defeat him. I remember Review and Herald editorials, well, after we left, that said very clearly, at least in letters from the editor, that Jesus did not have to worry about internal temptations. Well, that's where my temptations are. Because he took a different view, you see, of the humanity of Christ. And a biblical theology completely contrary to Heppenstall and to all those who have done their best to ridicule Andreessen and others since 57. Another fallout of QOD, the rise of theological liberalism, and some prefer the label progressive. And so many of my friends are there, because I write for Spectrum and I write for Adventists Today, but I constantly get the response of my friends on this side and that side, but I know that many of them who are reading those two magazines are getting the truth too in some of the other doctrines or other pieces that people write. These are good people who have been taught by teachers and theologians since 1957. They really don't know any better, and they'll die to support the teacher they were taught by. That's almost a factum, that people will die to support the teacher that taught them. And that's what happens. Good people get off on the wrong road, and because it's so pleasant, because of the suppositions they allow themselves to believe in, there's nothing wrong with it, because by presuppositions they tell me it's okay. Pre-1957 Adventists were called legalists by progressives, especially with their emphasis that God expects the people to be overcomers, Revelation 2:21 and many others. And that's where they get the false charge of perfectionism. You read it everywhere. But in those years following 57, a new desire to explain away the delay in the advent. A whole group of people in the Adventist Church have built up a large following of those who laugh at the concept that the Advent has been delayed, which leads to an eclipse of Ellen White, a rise of social gospel as the Adventist impulse. That's the way you're doing the Lord's work, in the social gospel. And then the outreach desire for the emotional foundation. You can't find it in doctrinal, theological legalism, because that doesn't work. You need it for the heart. You got to find Jesus. You've got to find the one that you're going to throw your life into. And you can identify all that with spiritual formation, contemplative prayer. Oh, we spend time on that other places. Anything that gives you the sense of immediacy with God, because you feel that way. When you think it through with your head so that your heart is straightened out. You need your head to straighten out your heart, but many times the heart straightens out the head. And that's the problem with too many are in today. And then the rise of the Adventist Magisterium. In many ways, the official word had come out in the 80s and in the 90s. Look, I was on the original BRI committee in 1964, 65. I was on it for a number of years. I know what BRI is and how it works. It works a little differently now. I knew how the leaders in the denomination were trying to stay together in the midst of all this coming and going. But it came to the place where pastors and teachers and writers should not speak out on certain subjects, such as the final atonement in the heavenly sanctuary and the humanity of Christ, because such topics are divisive. That's why, after a certain number of years in the 90s, you couldn't get anything into the Review and Herald on those subjects. And some editors in our publishing houses didn't want to touch it. It wasn't the standard line of the General Conference, the Magisterium. Of course, when I say General Conference, there are a number of the General Conference who would be sitting right here today, standing up and just plain appalling what I'm saying, because they feel the same way. It's not a slam dunk, folk. But sometimes when you read this and read that, you think that everybody's saying it, and it's not true. And then there's the astounding concerted attempt in the Magisterium to ridicule Andreasen. What a shame. And others, revealing the personal theological bias of those who ride the wind of mockery. And somehow, when you're in the area of near truth, it's easy to mock those who have the truth. Near truth, I think, is more dangerous than error. Because it comes wrapped up in church clothing. Good people can lose themselves in near truth. So what if the opportunities of a century, what if, let's look at the big picture now. We got to go 38,000 feet above in a 777, where you can really see the world below you. When you get down here and you're just looking at people and you're listening to this person, you let the kindness and the sweetness and the melodiousness of this person overwhelm you when you're saying, wait a minute, I don't see how you can say that. But you don't want to argue with them. But when you get above, you can say, whoa, this is what's going on. What if our QOD trio had not muted the second angel's message, Revelation 14? When they had these Calvinist evangelicals, Christian brothers, in their hand for almost 2 years, what if they had heard what Revelation 14 was trying to say to them? What if our evangelical friends had been given a picture of what is really going on in the closing events of the Great Controversy? You've seen these words before when you went to college or some other place. You've had a good book from John Milton's Areopagitica. I'm going to read it slowly. In the 1700s. Though all winds of doctrine were let loose to play upon the earth, so truth be in the field, we do injuriously by licensing and prohibiting to misdoubt her strength, truth's strength, to limit it, to license it. Let her and falsehood grapple. Who ever knew truth put to the worst in a free and open encounter? I've written that in the forefly of many of my books. And I wrote this too in some of my books. Plato is worth reading. Great mind. Set in motion many other minds down through the years. And so much of what he said was so clear, and some of it, of course, was so wild because he didn't understand what the soul was or whatever. But this is what he had Socrates advising Charmides. But what matter, said Charmides, from whom I heard this? And so Socrates says, why, no matter at all. The point is not who said the words, but whether they are true or not. Could anybody say that any clearer? In other words, in 1957, we had missed opportunities. It was a fatal attempt to merge successfully the Augustinian Calvinist evangelical sovereignty of God theme with a great controversy theme. The big question, what does God want to accomplish with his salvation plan? If they had just kept that question in front of everybody. And God sighed to restore in willing men and women the image of Christ, their maker. To do so, the Holy Spirit would work out of a person's life all that sin had worked in. You could take that to the bank, folk. The work of the Holy Spirit is to work out all that sin has worked in. So that eventually you're growing up, you're maturing, until it can be said you're mature. God, you're ready to be picked by God. In other words, you're ready to be sealed. That's all that sealing is. Picking the fruit of a mature person. All everywhere can be forgiven and transformed into overcomers, if willing. A promise throughout Revelation. Therefore, the following principles on God's side. The highest motivation is to honor God rather than to impress him. You pay your tithe to impress God? Or are you doing it to honor him? Character determines destiny. Boy, you can really rile up a school auditorium, a college auditorium, by talking like this. Because there's people on this side and people on that side. Character has nothing to do with it. Jesus did it. It's the character that matters most. Yes, but that's not all. Character determines your destiny. Perfection is a matter of continual growth and not a concern for arbitrary goalposts. I've got to get to this before I'm perfect. No. You don't say that to your tomato plant that some of you have planted already. You just keep looking at the way it grows. More leaves. Ooh, there's the first little green fruit. Then it's becoming bigger, more. Oh, yes. And time comes, you can finally eat it. And the best way to eat the first tomato is right there, hanging over so it doesn't drip all over your clothes. And eat it right there over the. That's the only way to eat a tomato. My father taught me that when I was 9 years old. And I haven't forgotten it at all. That's perfection. Nothing other than just growing up. And then growth, the linkage of human will and divine grace. I wish more people could understand that God never asks anything out of you that he's not going to develop in you. God isn't asking the impossible from us. He's just asking you to do what you think Jesus would do. Just ask Jesus. Watch what he did. Listen to Paul. That's all. Let him give you the grace to overcome, as well as the grace of pardon. Pardon and power are the two strongest words in the Adventist language. You can't have one without the other. Think about that now. You can't have one without the other. You think you can have power without pardon? You're on your own. You think you can have, well, I don't have to explain that anymore. Now this is the trap. The Adventist trio were first-class preachers. They're first-class writers who wanted their evangelical friends to see them as Christian brothers and not just another cult. The title of the book Martin was writing was The Christian and the Cults that he was writing during that time. And he changed that last chapter, let me tell you, into a very favorable chapter from his point of view. Our trio, with the best of intentions, trying to show them we were Christian brothers, fell into the trap of being good neighbors. Thus began 50 plus years of focus on some kind of objective atonement. The cross and justification, major focus, without an equal focus on the subjective aspect, that is, the highlighted Christ, Holy Spirit's work as high priest and empowerment. I hope I have something on that later on, I'm not sure. But you can't have an appeal to grow up without an understanding of how the Holy Spirit is working in this process. You can't really understand what Jesus did on the cross for you until you understand what the Holy Spirit is wanting to do now with Jesus in the holy place. If you don't get those two thoughts together, it's just murky out there. How does that work? I'll talk about it later, maybe. The first to react to all this was Andreasen. Can you imagine doing something high level with the best intentions from the evangelicals and not invite Andreasen into your group? Can you even imagine them keeping Andreasen away? He wasn't that far away. That's amazing. He began to see how this was going, because the book hadn't come out in 1957, but 1956, he was seeing the editorials in Ministry Magazine by Anderson, by Froome, by Louise Kloiser, all supporting these new doctrines. And he said, whoa. So he was writing to them privately. He was a gentleman. Andreasen was a gentleman. He wasn't sharing any of his comments with anybody except the persons involved. He finally was writing to the Figur, the President General Conference. And that wasn't so good. Andreasen, when Jesus died for us, he did not give us license to continue to sin, but to live responsibly in the Spirit. That was brand new to the evangelicals. Jesus died so that there would be a new kind of relationship with the Godhead. He started with the principle of God's freedom and man's responsibility, not God's sovereignty and man's predestination. The veteran theologian saw immediately that the Adventist tectonic plate would always be an immovable theological mass of interconnected truths. You can't start talking about Adventist theology without connecting the dots. You begin with the sin problem understood, then to understand the humanity of Christ, then to understand faith, then understand what the atonement really is, not cleaning up the utensils and hardware in heaven, but cleaning up men and women on earth, which has everything to do with the return of Jesus. You connect all those dots, you can't miss. but you got to start with the right dot. He saw the big picture, including the last generation of those who represent the truth about how people are made ready for Christ's return. That's Adventist talk. That's the kind of language you should be teaching in your Sabbath school classes. And he simply linked the purpose of the gospel with all that Jesus said about the end of the world, the sheep, the goats, according to their works. I don't know if Martin ever did read that any more than once in the Gospels. Now this man here, some of you in the room know, he's our systematic theologian, chief of the department at the seminary today. I think he just retired in the last week or two. Precious guy. He's currently writing in various magazines on contemporary issues facing the church, especially on the emerging church, and especially on spiritual formation, whatever. He's such a humble and respected among the staff. And he's called to serve the brightest minds in academia. We can be glad that he understands the great controversy theme. I didn't know him until I first read some things he wrote. Whoa, I wrote immediately back to him. This is what I think you is saying. This is what I understand. Boom, 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 boom. Then he writes back, you got it. So this is what he wrote. Biblical theology requires a center from which to gather the vast variety of issues, histories, and teachings present in biblical texts. You don't get the big picture just by knowing all you can know about the book of Acts, or about Nahum, or Jonah today in Sabbath school, or any other book. You can be an expert. You can recite it in Greek and in Hebrew. That doesn't mean you know very much about the great controversy. He's saying you have to have a center to gather the vast variety of issues. Thus, the proper expressions of the sanctuary doctrine as hermeneutical vision, that is the presupposition in which you can put everything into organization, of a complete and harmonious system which of truth requires the contributions of new approaches to biblical and systematic theologies. He's getting at a lot of theologians with this. From this foundational level, the sanctuary doctrine becomes the hermeneutical light. In other words, the basic principle that unfolds, guiding into the interpretation of these far-reaching ideas. In other words, the conditions of theological methods, and in the understanding of the complete and harmonious system of Christian theology. That whole article said that man has it. He's got the point. And then he goes on to explain, of course. But he's doing this in rigid theological language so that other theologians can say, yeah, I better look at what I'm doing. Now, this is Ellen White. The subject of the sanctuary was the key. He would say the hermeneutical principle, which unlocked the mystery of the disappointment of 1844. It opened to view a complete system of truth, connected and harmonious. Sounds like I'm quoting our systematic theologian. Knowing and showing that God's hand had directed the great Advent movement and revealing present duty as it brought to light the position and work of his people. As the disciples of Jesus, after the terrible night of their disappointment and anguish, were glad when they saw the Lord, so did those now rejoice who had looked in faith for his second coming after 1844, 1845, became clear, 1846, became clear, 47. Light from the sanctuary illumined the past, the present, and the future. Theologians make a whole paragraph out of that sentence. They knew that God had led them by his unerring providence who, like the first disciples, they themselves had failed to understand the message which they bore. Yet it had become in every respect correct in proclaiming they had fulfilled the purpose of God. And their labor had not been in vain in the Lord. That is in the 1844 disappointment. They're begotten again into a lively hope, and they rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. I love that chapter in Great Controversy. So, summarized, Andreessen and Canelli, the central principle for Adventist theologian in the sanctuary doctrine. Exactly what our QOD trio never seemed to understand. Exactly what Adventists today are so theologically divided regarding their core teachings. Whether Calvary was the full payment, and there was nothing more we needed to do for our salvation. What for? You can add to what Jesus did. He paid it all. You sing songs like that, don't you? Jesus paid it all. Not very good full theology. It was a means to an end. Whether character had anything to do with our salvation, whether Jesus had the DNA, the passions and inclinations of the forefathers that preceded him. Wrong answers lead to pure confusion. Okay, a little time out here. The handling of Ellen White. And what happened to Ellen White in the 1956-57 period didn't just drip. It flowed like an avalanche across the Adventist church. So that some of the nicest things that could be said about Ellen White was, and she was a good woman, and she has some very inspiring books. I love to read Desire of Ages. But theology? No, she just was a kleptomaniac. She just picked up stuff here and there from everywhere, and she got them in her books. But she's known for being inspirational, not being theological. And of course, my good friend Des Ford did his job, and a number of others you know well, on that line of thought. But they would say she was very inspirational. They don't put away Ellen White as being inspirational, but you don't go to her for theology. So much. It's the new normal today. In a Sabbath school class, if anyone brings up Ellen White in many churches, the magic use of using those ellipses to remove her real meaning, and then to continue the paragraph to display the opposite meaning. Because when you read Ellen White in QOD, and you say, well, nobody's going to misuse her. That's what she said. And for years, that's all I knew, until I found out for myself. I was puzzled. I didn't know what to think about it, except when I did go back. Well, not everybody has Signs of the Time periodicals. I do now, or the Review and Herald in their libraries at home. There's no real way to check on these things until somebody else can do it for you. And then in 1972, BRI published, that's the Biblical Research Institute, published a revised edition of the misleading quotes in QOD. When that came out, I said, whoa, I didn't think anybody had the guts to do it. And it was published. But I don't think very many people read it, is reading it. In fact, I don't think most people know that it's out to get a real picture. I never see it advertised. Now, examples of inadequate scholarship. ship when they misuse Ellen White. They use imported words in Questions on Doctrine. They're trigger words, as far as I'm concerned. Exempt and vicarious, until we got to the place, the teachers that I knew and young fellows coming out of the seminary were using those words as if they were God-blessed words. But Ellen didn't use those words. Especially when we're talking about Jesus and what kind of a man he became and how different he was from other babies. He was exempt from sin because he was born of the Virgin Mary. Ah, but the Catholic Church got around that years before the Adventists got to it, and they made Mary be born immaculately without sin, so she could have a body that could produce a baby without sin. Now that's putting one up on the Adventists, who still want to believe that Jesus was born like Adam was before he was sinned. It's amazing. We can go down that road some other time. Both terms pleased the Calvinists, because then we essentially agreed with them. Jesus was born exempted, and he was saved vicariously for us. He went through all the sins of man vicariously. He didn't sin, but he did it instead of us, whatever that means. But that's what I read in their books. But you see, we can't say exempt. Hebrews 2:17, 2:4:14, you go read them at home. You look at it and say, there's no exemption here. And Ellen White says, it would have been an almost infinite humiliation for the Son of God to take man's nature, even when Adam stood in his innocence in Eden. But Jesus accepted humanity when the race had been weakened by 4,000 years of sin, like every child of Adam. He accepted the results of the working of the great law of heredity. What these results were is shown in the history of his earthly ancestors. You want to know what kind of grandfathers he had? What kind of people fed into his bloodstream? Look at the ancestry. He came with such an heredity to share our sorrows and temptations and give us the examples of a sinless life. Yet into the world where Satan claimed dominion, God permitted his son to come, a helpless babe, subject to the weakness of humanity. He permitted him to meet life's peril in common with every human soul, to fight the battle as every child of humanity must fight it. At the risk of failure and eternal loss. That's why I entitled my book, God at Risk. You see, I had a momentary slip. I couldn't remember it. My wife is always ahead of me. She's always two steps ahead of me. God put himself at risk before the universe when Jesus agreed to come as a human being. That's a sermon in itself, of course. He did that for you and me. It was a risk because no human being ever was able to stand up to Satan before Jesus lived. And Jesus had to come to prove it. And by living as he did for 33 years, he proved Satan to be a liar. And that was part of the great controversy, to prove Satan a liar. Now he's waiting for other men and women to stand up and prove Satan a liar. Because if we don't do it, if people don't do it, through the years people have done it, of course, but here and there, God's waiting for a generation to stand up and make a point. If human beings can only say, you want me to be an overcomer and come to the place where Satan doesn't have anything in me, that's impossible. unless Jesus came down here and lived like I have to live, with the same temptations in heredity and temptations within your mind, temptations outside the book. Well, you mean to say Jesus did it to prove that I could do it by the same help that he had? Uh-huh. That gives me new hope. I know friends that go to this church and friends in this area who were the deepest into alcoholism, into addiction of all kinds, who listen to these simple words and are now being, in fact this weekend, are way up in Northern California giving series of sermons and lectures on this subject because of what God has done for them. Amazing Facts has a roster of people who have discovered that God's word is true. Simple, simple doctrine. That Jesus died to make you into man or woman who can be trusted to live forever, not just to be forgiven. We're not going to be forgiven criminals in heaven. We're going to be grown up sons and daughters of God, proving to the angels also who are standing at the gate, not let anybody in there who really can't be trusted. That's what faith is, by the way. Faith is simply trusting God and saying yes to God to whatever he asks you to do. And the more you live, the longer you live, the more you realize that there's more to do to please God. Oh, I better keep going here. This was Desire of Ages, by the way, 49 and 117. You never see those two pages in any of the books that are teaching you that you can't do it. I never see them. 49 and 117, and many more. Here's a good one. Christ's perfect humanity is the same that man may have through connection with Christ. Now, can you say it with simpler words than that? Some have written books unfolding the New Testament, and Ellen White, regarding the ample evidence that Jesus did not suffer vicariously, whatever that word means, when he was on earth. You'll find it in A Fork in the Road. I have appendices on all this subject. I think some of you have A Fork in the Road. The heartbeat of Adventism, I've gone through all this in Ellen White's writings. And if I'm sure they have some in the ABC, I wanted to get this on the program today. I couldn't get that changed over. Here's one by Dr. Zerscher, Touched by His Feelings. Now, friends, this book is a gold mine. Dr. Zerscher, I could tell you more about Zerscher. And this is by Ralph Larson, a very strong Adventist preacher, now passed on. It's entitled The Word Made Flesh, and it tells you what Adventists were thinking prior to 1957. Prior to 1957. It's all there. It's as if it doesn't exist in the minds of those who think QOD is the unfolding of Adventist doctrine. But the evidence is not alone. I'm trying to show you that we're not talking off the top of our heads, or a few people are on this side and a lot of people over there on that side. No, I don't have to do that. There are many biblical scholars, and I have them, most of them, or I can get to them in a few minutes, who challenge the orthodox evangelical Calvinism, which is predominantly in the systematic theologians and their theologies at any seminary. Some of these names you No. Edward Irving, Erskine, Kubrugin, Bowl, Carbart, Torrance, Ferret, Cranfield, Roberts, Newbegin, Stauffer, Anders Nygren, Ellen Barrett, Wolfert, Pettenberg, Baker, Johnson. It goes on and on. These aren't lunatic fringe. These are scholars. Cranford, for example, I know there are some in this room who know what ICC is, International Critical Commentary, which is the gold level of commentaries. After analyzing different ways of Romans 8, 3, and 4, which is kind of heart of the matter, that's in the likeness of sinful flesh. You know what that was? That's a phrase, in the likeness of sinful flesh. Cranford said, we conclude that the fifth interpretation is to be accepted as the most probable explanation of Paul's use of homoeuluma. That's the Greek word for likeness, homoeuluma. And understand Paul's thought to be that the Son of God assumed the self-same fallen human nature that is ours. Now, you don't have to appeal to any Adventist to say, what does Romans say? Go to the ICC. Gregory of Nazianzus in the 4th century. He had a lot to do, by the way, of settling the Arian controversy. He wrote, for that which he has not assumed, he has not healed. Talking about Jesus. But that which is united to his Godhead is also saved. In other words, Jesus became a real human being, and if he didn't, to that extent, he's not really saving you from anything. He may have died on the cross, but he's not saving you from sin. Oh, I love it. The second figure word, vicariously. Yes, Jesus died for us vicariously because I haven't died yet, but he died for me. He did die for me vicariously, but he was not our example vicariously. That's how it gets twisted. Some don't want Jesus to be like us, not too close, by the way, for then we would be without excuse. Did he keep the law vicariously? Did he pay tithe vicariously? Sometimes you wish you would. Did he resist evil vicariously? It's just simple thinking, folk. If those men, our Adventist trio, were reading the Review and Herald that came out every week, and they're reading Elder Nichols' editorials in 1952, the objector feels that the only way to honor the Son, the Christ, and to protect him from all taint of sin is to take the position that he could not sin. But what comfort and assurance of personal victory over sin can we find in a spotless Christ if his freedom from sin as he walked this earth was not fully a victory over temptation, but an inability to sin? If he couldn't sin, where's the victory? We would rightly stand in awe of such a holy being, but we could not see in him one who was made like unto his brethren in all respect, that's another translation, and one who, being tempted like us as we are, able to succor those who are tempted. No, you can't read Paul and get all mixed up like that. General Conference President W.H. Branson, what a man he was. He was a strong leader in our work in China until the communists took over. Branson was really a remarkable guy. President of General Conference, 1950-1954. But he became ill. And he did not stand for re-election, 1954. If he was re-elected, QOD would never got off the ground. I can assure you. Well, he wrote in a book that came out in 1054. I need a little change there. In order for Christ to be understood and the weakness of human nature, he had to experience it in order to be sympathetic with men in their trials. He also had to be tried. He must tread the same paths, live under the same circumstances, and die the same death. Therefore, he became bone of our bone and flesh of our flesh. His incarnation was in actual humanity. Is there anything hard about understanding that? That's what the church taught for 100 years. That's exactly what it wasn't teaching after 1957. I don't know how it all works. I sure would like to find out from the angels why Branson got sick. The multitude of similar writings in Adventist periodicals prior to 1957 is in this book by our good friend Ralph Larson, The Word Was Made Flesh. And then, ever since 1957, Azure sure did a real job on 1857. And we missed him by a few hours when we were in Geneva. My wife and I were coming down from, on the train from Amsterdam, and we had called ahead. We wanted to meet him. We got into Geneva and spent a night or two with him, and they weren't there at the station, so I called the house, and his wife said, Jean is in the hospital. I don't think he's going to live very long. I said, oh man, it came too late, because Dr. Zersher and I had such a close fellowship in so many ways, but that's what happened. We missed him before he died. But that book is a testament to anybody. Well, I gotta move on. The attempted compromise. Now there's some in this room that have to understand what I'm going to say now. Because this is an attempt in the last 10 years to show that, right, we were wrong in 1957. Jesus did take the liabilities of mankind, but not the kind that you're thinking. When I first read about this, coming out in several periodicals, I said, wait a minute, how are they going to think this one through? In other words, the pre-fall and the post-fall, and this is a mediating position. And so Jesus inherited the weakness of our innocent infirmities, such as hunger, pain, sorrow, and death. But he came only in the likeness of sinful flesh. That is, he did not inherit a tendency to sin or sinful propensities. I shook my head a little bit. How do you get that? Well, they referred to an article in the Review and Herald. I thought I had it here. Well, probably get back to the propensity. A bent, an enticement to temptation. And if you resist a bent, if you resist inclination, you resist temptation, you're not sinning. James 1, a whole chapter on it. Propensity becomes evil only when it yields to temptation, James 1:12. I'm looking at all these texts, and I'm saying, well, how can they put this in print? The basis for this new compromise, a misunderstanding of words that seemed to be borrowed from Henry Melville. Then that gave me, I got the clue. He was an Anglican preacher, 1798-1871. His sermon, Christ, Man's Example, was published in Review and Herald, 1887. How that got through the editors, I don't know, but the words are very tricky, and maybe they're traveling somewhere, and they saw Man's Example, we believe in that, and that's where they put it in. But Melville taught that fallen human nature had two characteristics, innocent infirmities and sinful propensities. That Jesus took the first and not the second, but Adam had neither. Perfect! And that's what's in the book, annotated. QOD. And that's supposed to be the gospel ever since this book came out. And some of us, we just shake our head. How could you think that way? Melville was a Calvinist. He was a Federalist. And for those who know your theology, you know that they believe that they were born sinful, like God made people sinful and unsinful at birth. And that's how you develop. Sinful people have sinful inclinations. Ellen White, no doubt, did read Melville. I think she probably did. She read the review, and many other people did. And I think she borrowed some of these phrases that other people were using because they spelled out her thoughts in interesting, helpful language. But it is very unwise, folk, to go to Melville or Hannah or Daubigny to understand what Ellen White meant by the words that she would use from these books, because we know she used words from these books, no question. But she didn't use their theology. She used their descriptive language. She was very careful. Yeah, I wrote a whole book on this, Messenger of the Lord. Ellen was a very careful user of somebody else. When I quote somebody, I'm quoting them all the time. You see that in my books, I have loads of quotations, but I make sure I'm not quoting people who disagree with what I'm writing. I may use their words, but only at the point where I can agree with what they're saying, descriptive words. Ellen White's borrowing certain words did not alter her thought, just made her own meaning more pleasing and forceful. Ellen knew how to distinguish truth from error, even when gleaning. Logic tells us that when we're using certain words, an author may seem troublesome. Why did she do that? Then you analyze how that author uses those words in other situations. Anybody can do it with my books. What did Douglas mean here? Well, over here, this is what he meant. Oh, I see now. He just didn't elaborate enough over here. It didn't intend to. And that's how you track Ellen White's. That's what I did in this book here, trying to give Ellen White a fair shake. Heartbeat of Adventism on the subjects that really matter most. And so corruption, propensities, and passions are clearly understood by reading Ellen White's own usage. And I have that all tracked in there too. You have to be fair to an author. Don't just run away with a paragraph that doesn't sound just right until you find out how she used those words over here and over here. And Andreessen's second concern was the atonement. And they used Ellen White, rightly so, they used Ellen White in Questions on Doctrine on the benefits of the atonement that she wrote in early writings. But Andreessen said, yeah, but read the whole chapter. If you read the whole chapter and find out what she means over here and here in great controversy, you would understand it doesn't mean just sharing the benefits of the cross. It's the benefits of the full atonement, of what they're doing for you through the Holy Spirit. Oh my. The full passage in early writings, 253, 261, explained what is meant by benefits, which was not in Questions on Doctrine. And that's another place where we didn't really treat Barnhouse and Martin right. They never got the full picture. But this satisfied them. But the Adventists were confused. What were the benefits of his high priestly ministry? And as the typical cleansing of the earthly was accomplished by the removal of the sins by which it had been polluted, so the actual cleansing of the sanctuary is to be accomplished by the removal or blotting out of the sins which are there recorded. But before this can be accomplished, there must be an examination of the books of record to determine who are these people that are being recorded, who through repentance and of sin and faith in Christ are entitled to the benefits of, okay, what are those benefits? The cleansing of the sanctuary therefore involved a work of investigation, a work of judgment, and this work must be performed prior to the coming of Christ to redeem his people, for when he comes, his reward is with him to give every man according to his works. I can go on and on, where the sanctuary in heaven is a symbol of, and the sanctuary on earth in Moses' day is a symbol of what God wants to do within your human heart. This is the sanctuary he wants clean. This is what he's atoning everything for. When you keep our mind on symbols, which are of great teaching function, how you can understand better by seeing the symbol, oh, I understand that. You mean, as you cleanse the sanctuary there, that means you're cleansing my heart here? So when the time comes when you're all through with your sanctuary work in heaven, that must mean that all the people on earth who want to be cleansed are cleansed, and those who don't want to be cleansed, they shall be filthy still? Yeah, that's what it stands for. Oh, any child can understand that, and that's a fact. Every child can understand the cleansing of the sanctuary when the heart is what's meant to be cleansed, and not just furniture in heaven. That's a symbol to tell us what the real... You'll read all this in Book Education, by the way. Oh, it's our page 671, Question on Doctrine, ministry article before and after the printing of QOD, plus the book itself, convinced Antriason that they had little understanding of the immense purpose of God's Christ's work as whole priest. The cleansing of his people, not merely furniture as in the earthly symbols. The Spirit was to be seen, given as a regenerating agent, and without that, the sacrifice of Christ would have been of no avail. If Christ is not regenerating people, getting ready for heaven, then it was a big failure on the cross. The cross was a means to an end. The end being preparing you to live forever. Catholics, Protestants, Buddhists, Muslims, all over the world, helping them to see the big picture. Well, immediately after 1957, Andreessen's seven letters went out. People are asking me today about them. They went out in the 1960s. These were letters that he wrote to the church in his day when he saw that nobody was listening to him. The General Conference took away his retirement and gave it to him several days after he died. These were tough times, folks. He wrote those letters out. You can get them. They're available in different places. How he wrote to the church about where he saw the problems. And Of course, Bob Brittenmead and the Awakening Group, and Bob Hancock's 1962 seminary thesis. Perhaps the last thesis on this subject, humanity of Christ, that's been published, well, since 1962. Oh, there are other ones on humanity of Christ. I've read them. They asked me for my opinion, my write-up. And I told them, I wouldn't give this person a D minus for this dissertation. But they published it as if no comment has ever been made. These are good guys. These are very honest men with presuppositions taught by other teachers that they continue to pass on. So what can we do today to rectify the mistakes? Remember that the Quixote trio were godly men who are not equally matched with the Calvinist evangelicals. The fundamental issues are not merely semantical problems. Remember that every theological system is based on the personal suppositions of the writer or teacher. Remember that in 1957, the Adventist theological system was on firm ground when it bumped into the Calvinistic tectonic plate. Something worse than the San Francisco earthquake. And remember that thought leaders, including Nickel and Branson and Cottrell, Neufeld, Andreessen, Wood, during those 1950 years, built their theological contributions on the great controversy theme, quietly, carefully, joyfully. And to call them the lunatic fringe. Well, today it's laughable. It wasn't laughable then. And remember that closing events in world history will be preceded by the Holy Spirit's promise of the latter rain. That the latter rain falls on prepared people, and then through them, the power of the latter rain. Dear friends, every time we hear about praying for the Holy Spirit, remember one thing. It's character before power. Not power, and then you hope you're going to find character. It's not the emotion first, and then some good thing afterwards. It's the character preparation where God can, through the early rain, say that person is ready for the maturing of the latter rain. And remember that QOD tends to diminish all these simple facts. And remember above all else that the prophetic assignment of the Adventist Church, as outlined in Revelation 7, 12, and 13 and 14, will be fulfilled by some generation of Adventists who recovers the message as outlined in the Great Controversy theme. Some generation will be the last generation. Believe it. Love it. Live it. And afterthoughts, from cowardice that shrinks from the truth, from laziness that is content with half-truths, from the arrogance that thinks it knows all truth, O God of truth, deliver us. Thank you, Heavenly Father. This has been quite a journey for these people today. It's been a long time sitting. Please, Lord, stamp into their minds just some of the things that they've seen and heard today. Help them sense the joy of letting truth percolate in their mind, because it always leads to something else. It always leads to some new adventure in learning something fresh. Lord, we don't want to disappoint you. And we don't want to disappoint each other. But we pray in the name of our Father, Lord Jesus, and Holy Spirit, whom we want to meet one of these days real soon, face to face. Thank you, Lord. hurry. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
You've been a hero this afternoon. Spoken for a long time.
It's been wonderful.
Yeah, thank you. You can have a drink of water now, by the way. I think you should. We just want to thank you again for coming. I went by the ABC the other day, and I got Dr. Douglas's book, A Fork in the Road. It's published by, this one is by Remnant. The other books here, this one here, The Heartbeat of Adventism, that's Pacific Press. So I just want to encourage you, if you don't have, you should get these, but if you don't have this one, which really covers everything you've mentioned this afternoon, correct?
Yeah, a little more.
You should get this. You can get it at the ABC. Where else? You can directly from Remnant. Does Amazing Facts carry this?
Oh, yeah.
They do as well. Okay. All right.
Usually do, I guess.
Yes. All right, well, you've said it all, so thank you again for coming, and God bless you. And what we want to do, we've spoken about this, sometime in the very, very near future, Dr. Douglas will come back to do another presentation on the great controversy theme. We were planning to have him 2 weeks today, but it didn't work out, so just kind of check on our website, www.saccentral.org, and you'll see then when we're going to have him back again. So thank you, God bless you. We want to thank your wife for lending you to us this afternoon, and you can have him back now. Thank you very much. God bless you, and thanks for coming. Have a good afternoon.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
You're wonderful.